Welcome back for the finals. Still playing this sweet black-white deck with the Chiefs, the Sky Skiffs, and the double underhanded designs. We won the die roll. We're going to play first. Ooh, two lands on the play. 1-2 drop, a couple 3 drops. 2-5 drops. This is a close call. Before the Scry Mulligan, I would have definitely always kept this. I do think you can mulligan a little more now, but I think with 17 lands, we pretty much have to keep this. And I mean, have to isn't really a great word, because I think it is very close, but I think it's right to keep it. If we end up stuck on 3 for a little bit, it shouldn't be too bad. Most of our deck costs 3 or less mana. But we do pretty badly need to draw one swamp. But, you know, we have 8 sources, the one concealed courtyard and the 7 swamps. And I think trying to draw one of those is better than mulliganing. By trying to, I just mean hoping we do. Mulliganing is pretty bad. Like, it's, you know, it's not the end of the world to go to 6 with the scry. But if your hand is only missing basically one thing from being a good hand, it's probably not something you want to do. Just going to revoke that since we don't have any other possible plays, and we need as much time as possible, and basically to hope the opponent doesn't have much. Okay, that's good. Them not doing anything on 4, and us drawing 2 creatures in 1 in Glintsleeve Artisan. We're still not in great shape, but certainly we're back to live if the opponent can't deal with what we have, and or we are able to draw some swamps. This is a very winnable game. Most likely they have one removal or something, like a Harness Lightning or a Welding Sparks, but that's no big deal. So, Glintsleeve Artisan was a good draw. Swamp would be our best draw this turn, I think. It's a pretty good creature. Yeah, can't really do anything. So, now we're just gonna attack for 2. Of course, this isn't a race we're winning, but we don't really have options. If we draw a land, we'll be able to make a bunch of blockers. If we draw a swamp, we can play a flyer and then make a bunch of blockers, or just make the blockers first. This way, they can't really attack us. This could end up being tight if we draw a swamp. Could be a really good game. If we don't draw lands, then we're definitely going to lose. Okay, so we drew plains. Nowhere near as good as swamp, but still pretty good. So now we have 3 creatures again. And going to go ahead and trade 2 for 2, I think, with the skiff still. No, it really just doesn't make sense. We want this game to go as long as possible. I'm thinking we're the aggro deck, we're on the play and all of that, and we're hitting first. But ultimately, we want this game to go long so that we can get our 3 self-assemblers, use our tidy conclusion. So 2 for 2 doesn't make sense, and even if they played an artifact, it might have become 3 for 2, which definitely wouldn't make sense. So it was right to not attack with the Sky Skiff last turn. Unfortunately, our deck is not coughing up swamps. But the opponent only has 1 card in hand, so we're not in that bad a shape on board. If they don't have anything, we can use the build to last to take out one of the Wayward Giants. I'm not trying to trick them or play around anything, I don't think. So I think we'll just block with the Servo and the Skiff. This way, whichever one they put first, we can build to last that, and then they won't have enough power to take out the other one. If we triple block, if the opponent has anything, then they might go for it. But if they didn't and passed, we would just have to play it anyway. And if they put the augmenter first, then there's nothing we can pump with build to last where we don't go on to lose a creature. So given I don't think we can really beat a removal anyway, I don't think we need to try and provoke them into using a removal. I think that all we really want to do here is not throw away an extra 1/1. So hopefully they just don't have anything. They already played 3 removal spells. They have Unlicensed Disintegration. That's really bad for us. Okay. Definitely could have went for the triple block. It might have been right. We're not in that bad of shape. Like I said, maybe the opponent would have used the Disintegration, and we could have responded with Build to Last. If they didn't and they just passed, I would still make the Build to Last play, and then it would work out even worse for us. So, kind of a difficult spot. Now I think we're just dead. Those two have Menace, can't block the Flyer. Yeah, we're just dead. So kind of a difficult spot, but a really tough game to win if they have Disintegration there anyway. Not unwinnable, so I'm not saying my play was definitely correct. It was a close play, but it was a tough spot to win if they had that, so I chose to make the play that I thought was just best if they didn't have that. Okay, I don't think against their deck we need to be slightly bigger, so I think Inventor's Goggles for pressure point is going to be good. We saw Hijack and 2/5 mana, 4/5 Giants, so pressure point actually seems quite good against them. Inspired Charge is probably pretty bad in this matchup. So I think I like bringing in both pressure points for Goggles and Inspired Charge. I think we can accomplish considerably more with killing their big creatures or tapping them than we can by trying to grind through them. I feel like that's the kind of matchup this is. Plus, we have the triple Self-Assembler, which is really great for grinding against a black-red deck anyway. All right, this hand looks reasonable, just missing a swamp again. Can't do anything about that, but let's hopefully draw one, and if not, then we can get going. Okay, since there's no guarantees on the servo being able to attack, I'm just going to get out the underhanded designs first, start draining them. I think we can use the life for races later. It's not like the opponent's a pure control deck. So I want to get in as much draining as I can in this match and get my designs in play. Though, of course, next turn, if the opponent doesn't do anything, it's highly unlikely I would choose to, say, sack Puzzle Nut and drain for one rather than play Augmenter and miss the drains. Knowing I have Self-Assembler for 5 and then Self-Assemblers forever, I do want to... you know, make the most impactful plays I can. It looks like the opponent misclicked through their turn and then discarded a land rather than playing it. It's kind of unfortunate. There's nothing I can really do about that, but it's not something I root for. I often don't even send in videos when stuff like that happens in key games, but I feel like we've played some really good games, and this was a pretty interesting draft, so I'm still going to send this one in. But, you know, it's unfortunate. Never root for anything like that. Would like my opponent to have their land in play and not to lose due to a misclick. As far as our turn, I think that we should be deciding between Augmenter and Chief of the Foundry, where I was going to definitely Augmenter over... just sacking Puzzle Nut. Now that we have Chief and we get a point of extra damage and use all of our mana, I'm no longer sure what the right play is. If we do play Augmenter and the opponent doesn't have Make Obsolete, it's going to be better for us. But if we put out the Chief first, we get some protection from Make Obsolete. One thing I really don't like, though, is that we saw Harness Lightning. So it's pretty convenient for the opponent right now with their two up to be able to Harness Lightning something like a Chief. Whereas if I play the Augmenter, they wouldn't have any good targets for Harness Lightning. They also have a Pyro Helix, which is better against Augmenter than Chief. They'll get to take out Augmenter and a Servo. If I play the Chief, they have no real play with that. And we actually saw that last game too. We saw one Die Young, one Pyro Helix, one Harness Lightning, Hijack, and the Unlicensed Disintegration, I believe. So, all in all, I think it's pretty close, but I think we're going to want to play the Augmenter. So I think we're just going to attack for one with the Servo. If I saw Make Obsolete, I definitely wouldn't make that this play. That's the main card that we can really play around by playing the Chief, and we're really not playing around by making this play. But the reality is, we don't know what they have. We have no reason to put that card in their hand or even card pool necessarily. And when we play the Chief next turn, we would have the potential to deal a lot more damage. We no longer do since the opponent played a 2-3, but there are a lot more 3-2s than 2-3s. Well, not necessarily a lot more, but there are more, and there aren't that many 3 toughness creatures that the opponent was that likely to have for this turn. And it would be stopping our other attack anyway, so it's not a huge deal. Okay, so now we have to make decisions. We could play the Chief and Underhanded Designs, the Pillar Bug. Deal 6, the Designs is gone, but it's a lot of damage, and we have a pretty sizable army. Or we can play the Self-Assembler, search out another one, have a good attacker for next turn, and pretty much the same options. I think that makes more sense. If the opponent plays something considerably better than Pillar Bug, I'd rather Designs that. And knowing that we have two more Self-Assemblers, a Chief in hand, and a Puzzle Knot in play, we really have the potential to do a lot of draining, even though knowing that we don't have lands and we have all these spells, we're probably not going to have that much spare mana to drain with. So there is definitely reasons for doing like any of those reasonable lines this turn. I think casting Self-Assembler was totally reasonable and probably correct. That's why I chose it. But if you wanted to, let's say, sack the Designs to kill the Pillar Bug and play the Chief and hit them for 6, I certainly wouldn't fault you. I think that's a close play. I think the decision between those two lines is very close. So now I see the option to play the Chief, which means they basically can't block the Self-Assembler. They'd have to double block it and lose both and attack with just a Self-Assembler. Or we could play the Chief, drain for 1, play the Patrol and attack with everybody. Their block with the Lawless Broker and Pillar Bugs on the Servos aren't great for me. Kind of a 2-for-1, but they're only trading off with a 1-1. But the Bridge Patrol will grow to a 3-3 and be a real creature pretty much immediately. Or we could attack with just the Self-Assembler and then use the Underhanded Designs if they double block, which would be pretty good for me in that it would take out both of their creatures, but pretty bad for me in that the Underhanded Designs wouldn't still be in play to take care of one of the Giants, which we know they have 2 of in their deck, or to drain with. The nice thing, though, is if they don't want to get blown out on that double block and they take the 4, then post-combat we can just play another Self-Assembler, drain for 1, and pass. So if I knew they weren't going to block, I would definitely attack with just Self-Assembler. And I don't know if they're going to block, but if they do, it's not really that bad for me. But it's certainly not great either. So I think I can take that. Let's actually envision the board the following turn. So I attack with the Assembler, they double block, I kill one with the Designs. I then play the Bridge Patrol, sack the Puzzle Knot, end of turn. So I still have everything in play because the Assembler lived. Then I don't draw anything of consequence. I play the Chief. I attack with everything, and they're still at 18, though. So the end result, well, actually, they're at 17. I can sack the Puzzle Knot and drain for, no, I can't. 2 for the Puzzle Knot, 2 for the Patrol. Okay, but I'm not going to attack with the Patrol anyway, I doubt. So maybe I pay the 1 and drain with the Puzzle Knot. So they're at 17, let's say. And then I play the Chief. I can play the Patrol and attack with everybody. If they block one of these with, like, let's say a 4-5 Giant or some other big creature they play, they will take 2, 4, 6 damage because I have 1 other Servo from the Puzzle Knot and 5 from the Assembler. So that's 11. So they go from 18 down to 7, and they eat a 1-2-2 Servo, and the Bridge Patrol grows. Let's say after that, they're able to kill the Chief, though, because we know they have plenty of removal. What am I left with? I'm left with an Assembler, three servos and a 2-2 or 3-3 bridge patrol. The opponent's at 7, and they have a 4-5, which is stopping my 2-4-4s. It's really close. All right, so I think I'm close enough to winning that way, and there's the good chance that they just don't double block here because I get to blow up both creatures. So I think attack with just self-assembler is the right play. I'm definitely hoping that they do not double block. But if they do, then we go ahead and take one out with the underhand designs, get our 2-for-1, and progress the game in that way. If they do not double block, which they chose not to, then we go ahead and play the assembler and drain them. And I'm not saying the opponent's play was wrong. I actually thought they probably wouldn't double block. The reasons are, it's not just about this underhanded designs. I could just kill both their creatures and have my assembler live with, you know, Rush of Vitality or Subtle Strike or Impeccable Timing, you know, or Build to Last. I mean, you know, if they knew for a fact I had none of those and they would be removing underhanded designs, I think there's a decent chance that they go ahead and make the double block. But they're more afraid of any possible combat trick resulting in a 2-for-1, my assembler living, both creatures dying. They don't know that they get to kill a terror that, you know, sits in play, can take out the best creature whenever, and lets me drain. Okay, so now I feel like this is going to be a pretty easy Chief of the Foundry. The attack is just too good, and there's just too much going on. So I think, and there's no way we need to kill one of the opponent's creatures here. So I think that this is just cast the patrol so that if they do any trading, our creatures grow. Cast the chief. Drain them for one. And then clear attack with everything. There's nothing for one red that the opponent can play. I think the only one red trick in the format is Build to Smash, which only works on attackers. So this is just a great attack and a great turn. And nothing in question for us. It's unfortunate that the opponent really had to discard that mountain on turn 3 instead of playing it, that they clicked through their turn. Because we're pretty far ahead, but the opponent has some decent stuff, so this could have definitely been a much better game if they played that Pillar Bug a turn earlier and had all their resources that they should have. They keep attacking, so I'm guessing that they're holding Build to Smash and that they need me to make some kind of block where they can play that and gain a bunch of life. So I'm not going to block. I'll just keep taking this Pillar Bug, and if they want to use it just for the life gain, they can. No need to put creatures in the path of that Build to Smash. Okay, so game 3. Sorry about what happened to the opponent, but definitely going to try and win. I'm trying to collect trophies. I tweeted a little while ago, BenS8528, for anybody who doesn't follow me, that I want to win the draft trophy championship in this league. It's not something that I'll always be able to try and do, because I have to test for a lot of constructed tournaments sometimes, but my next tournament isn't till the Grand Prix the week before or the Pro Tour itself in Dublin, so I've got about a 6-week break now. So what better to do with our winter vacation than see if we can be the person who wins the most drafts in this league. Not doing that well at the moment. I've got 11, 12 hopefully after this next game, and first has 29 or something. But I am gaining on them, since I do have a lot of free time and I do draft a lot. Okay, so game 3. A reasonable hand. Certainly no chance we would ever mulligan it. 2 drops, 3 drops, 4 land. It takes a lot to get me to mulligan a 3 or 4 lander in booster draft. Like, those are the numbers of land you want to see in your opening hand for most decks. So, I mean, once you start talking about 5 land 2 spells or 2 land 5 spells, there are hands that you can mulligan. But when you have 3 lands and 4 spells, or 4 lands and 3 spells, your hand has to be really something just beyond special in order for you to be able to mulligan. Like, it needs to be extremely awkward. Okay, here we have a choice. The Puzzle Knot gives us a 1-1 this turn, and it's something we can pick up with Mechanic later. The Skiff gives us 2 power. I think we'd rather have 2 power than 1. Since we do have 5 lands and only 4 spells, and they're not even very expensive, I think we'll be able to get the most out of our cards. I think what's more important right now is just dealing all of the damage we can and putting our stuff out there. Make the Servo, which I've been doing fairly automatically in this draft, but for example, with the opponent having a 2-3 out, it's not crystal clear that you just don't make Glintsleeve Artist in a 3-3. My reasons are Avery Mechanic, though I have the Puzzle Knot, so that's probably not super relevant, and the opponent has a lot of removal. Having seen Die Young, Harness Lightning, Unlicensed Disintegration, I'm not really trying to pile on one creature. But given the opponent mold to a 5, I believe, and they only have 3 more spells in hand, it certainly could have been correct to make the Glintsleeve Artist in a 3-3 when staring down a 2-3. My logic is also that I'm going to have so many small creatures that it's not like alphaing isn't going to happen, or it's not like making this a 3-3. It's the only card in play, so if it's a 3-3, it's stopping the bug and we're in a stalemate, but if it's a 2-2 and it's a 1-1, like, nothing good is happening. If they want to attack, I'd be happy to trade with the Pillar Bug. And if they want to hold it back, like, I don't think that I'm in a position where I'm going to be able to attack with this Glintsleeve Artisan as a 3-3, because then the bug's going to attack back. So basically, I think it was right to play the Artisan and make a Servo, but it's not by a lot. It's a close play. And it would be totally reasonable not to do it. Also in consideration was I can Mechanic back the Artisan. I don't have to make a Servo the second time. I can make it a 3-3 the second time if that's what I wanted to do. I don't think I'm going to do that. I think I'm just going to play the Puzzle Knot and Mechanic it now. Use all my mana and put out as much as I can. Even though it's entirely possible that these little creatures in play won't end up really doing anything. I do have the triple self-assembler to draw, the underhanded designs, and some other removal too. So I have to prepare for the long game here, I think. And I think I stand a pretty good chance to win a long game. And in the meantime, I basically am going to try not to get blown out on the ground, knowing the opponent has Built to Smash, Pyro Helix, and basically just all of this removal. My goal is to not end up in a situation where I get completely wrecked. Like, for example, if I double block this Pillar Bug, they are probably going to play Harness Lightning, Built to Smash, or Chandra's Pyro Helix, and I could end up in a position where I'm not able to stop this bug. Meanwhile, next turn, I can put 7 power and toughness on it, and then there will be no one removal spell they can play, or Built to Smash, where it will go on to live. So I think I'm going to take it this turn. And then even if I draw a brick, I'll have the ability to hit him for 2 with the Skiff, play the Puzzle Knot, sack the Puzzle Knot, and put 7 onto the Pillar Bug, which is kind of the magic number right now, as I think it will work through everything. Of course, Underhanded Designs potentially changes that. Now I can just kill their one good creature that's spectacled here. If I want to. I also have the option to attack for 2, play the designs, and then I can just double block the Pillar Bug, and if they do anything, I can kill it. If they don't do anything, then I can let the 2/2/2s trade for it, which is a pretty good trade for me, I think, and then go on to keep it around to drain a bunch of times with this Puzzle Knot and kill their next big creature. So I think that's what we're going to do. So I think that's going to be attack with Sky Skiff. The opponent has 2 cards in hand. They could be holding 1 land. They're almost certainly not holding 2 lands, as they might need to cast a 5-drop. activate the bug. They probably we did see all those cheap instant removal and tricks, the ones I named, Harness Lightning, Pyro Helix, and Built to Smash, I believe. In addition, we've seen a Die Young, Unlicensed Disintegration, Hijack. So I think it behooves us to keep this underhanded designs around if we can. So that's why I took this line. Okay, so the opponent played the Pyro Helix. So now I can't sack the designs, so there's no reason to keep it open. They did it in response so that I wouldn't have the option to sack it, which is fine. I don't think I wanted to sack it anyway, but that's not really the point. That's the correct play. There's no reason to give me options, let's say. But so now we will go ahead and play the Puzzle Knot. We get a drain for one. We miss one potential drain for one this way. But now that they used Pyro Helix and cleared out the 2/1s, we could definitely use the creatures in play. So now we have a choice. If they attack, do they have another thing that we want to play around? I think it's unlikely. I mean, it's possible, of course. But I think in this position, there's no real reason to get that frisky. We can just wait a turn and then have underhanded designs available. So I don't really want to make any blocks that can result in getting blown out, at least not blown out horribly. If we want to double block this Malphite Squad with a 2-2 and a 1-1, only Built to Smash is bad for us, and removal doesn't really work. But if they just pass and kill both, it's not awesome for us, although it is something I would consider acceptable. If they use the Built to Smash, then we don't take like a lot of trample or anything, and we get rid of it. We have the two creatures out for next turn to trade with the squad, and we sack the designs to kill the pillar bug if we don't draw anything. But we definitely could afford to just take the 7 here. We could also they also could easily make this attack holding nothing. So we definitely could just double block the pillar bug, but I don't really want to do that. And I don't think we really need to preserve these, like, 2-2 bodies. So I think there's not, I don't think there's enough of a difference between waiting to trade off a 1-1 artifact creature for this Malphite Squad and just offering up 2-2s for it right now. So I think that if we double block it, it's pretty good for us. If they have Built to Smash, we still kill the squad. It kills both of our creatures. If they have a removal, it does nothing. The only thing that's bad for us, if they have, I think it's called Rush of Vitality, +1/+0, Lifelink, and Indestructible. But we saw a lot of tricks in removal and haven't seen that, I don't think. So I'm pretty sure this block is correct, and hopefully they don't have, like, that card. But nothing else really is great. Subtle Strike isn't, like, awful for us. It's not great, but it's not awful. Built to Smash is not great, not awful. And trading a 2-2 for a 3-1 Menace here is good for us. So that was pretty favorable. Not favorable is drawing another land. So now we have a decision. Ultimately, of course, we're going to sack the Puzzle Knot drain, but we could underhanded designs the pillar bug and just like attack as much as we want to, or we could hold back and have this mechanic and skiff to double block the pillar bug. And if we do that, if they can't do anything to wreck us, or we can use the designs, I don't think we're going to need to design something better than this pillar bug. Since it has lifelink and menace now, I think it's pretty much better than a giant, the 4/5 that we saw 2 of. So I think there is advantages to staying in a stalemate with the designs out, but given we don't have any more artifacts in hand, and I think if we draw self-assembler, it's going to be more than enough to win this game anyway. I think here we just want to get kind of aggressive. We could not trade 1-1 for 1-1, but I think that gives the opponent more potential than it gives us. Even though we have chiefs that can make our creatures bigger or an inspired charge, we're going to be attacking next turn with both servos, or could be if we draw any creature to activate skiff, and we're winning the race. So I think this is the right turn. I don't know what they could have. Okay, they're just Harness Lightning. Them having another removal made perfect sense. I don't know why they really wouldn't do it if I didn't sack the design, but it's all the same. Oh, I guess they may not even have had the opportunity to do it yet. So basically, instead of doing it end of turn, they just did it then to save a little time. Anyways, so that was a totally reasonable play, and I think we did good there. We avoided all blowouts. We underhanded designed a 4-4 lifelink. And we worked through Pyro Helix and Harness Lightning, two instant removal spells. There's no way we're going to revoke any of the creatures in play now. They're just 1/1s. They're not blanking us. So it's a race we're winning, so we'll attack. And the opponent can block, sack, kill a 1-1 or not if they want to try and preserve the gremlin for a better artifact. And we're just going to hang out. We have to play that land because if we draw Self-Assembler, it's important that we're able to play Self-Assembler and revoke privileges in the same turn. You know, the opponent may play land 5 and play the 4-5 giant, and we may need to revoke it. Instead, they played Torch Gauntlet, which was actually reasonably good for them at in this exact spot, since we're holding a revoke, but revoke kills a creature and not, you know, an equipment. They can move the equipment off it and put it on something else. That said, we're still in a very favorable position, of course. No need to play the last land. So now with the opponent at 4, if they pass the turn, we could revoke, and if all they have is the ability to sack to kill the servo, they would be dead with the 1 point of drain from the Night Market Lookout, plus the 1 point of power, plus the 2 from the mechanic. I'm not ecstatic about revoking a gremlin, because if they have a different instant removal in their hand, then they can kill one of these, and then they only go to 1, and then if they can do 2 things on the following turn, they would win. But we did pull both instant removal here that we had seen previously. I mean, there is Unlicensed Disintegration too, but that's about it. And they would have to do 2 things on the following turn. Though one of them they could have on board, it would still cost 3 of their potential 5 mana. So I think if they pass the turn, we almost definitely will revoke privileges, this Ruinous Gremlin. But I might hold my nose a little bit as I cast it, because there are conceivable lines of play that will get them out of that, and then I'll have revoked a Ruinous Gremlin, so I, of course, will not be happy at all about that, but I think it gives us the highest chance to win. Okay, so a little bit of a curveball. Not bad for us, but they hijacked our Night Market Lookout. So they're going to 5, and they're dealing us 2. And now with 1 black open, I don't even think there's anything they can do. I think they're just going to take 5. I'm not even sure there's a card in the format. All the black tricks pretty much cost 2, Subtle Strike, and the Lifelink Indestructible trick. So they're dead. Sweet. Thanks for watching this one. It was fun.